Someone had the blockchain question gun firing early. Thank you. Yes, that's awesome. Look forward to more of that. And thank you, Steve, for your talk. As you'll see, I have roots in mechanical engineering originally, so the value stream mapping, quite awesome, reminding me of industrial manufacturing and also Goldratt's book, The Goal, which is related in an interesting read around finding that critical gene. So awesome stuff, thank you. So I'm gonna make a statement, and I have 20 minutes in a fairly complex an emerging space to talk about something that I feel is happening, and I'll do my best to sort of show at the 10,000 foot level some evidence that I think is pointing to this. And that's that blockchain will accelerate the shift to more autonomous self-managed work. I think as a development group, that's fairly easy to understand as we've watched how autonomous teams are developing software these days. I'd like to argue that that's going to be accelerated by the blockchain. So, brief history of myself. As I said, I did start as a mechanical engineer. Back in 2005, I was doing what mechanical engineers do. I was working on passenger railroad equipment and the design of it. Consulting, traveling around the globe for about 6 years doing that. I really started to discover I was a bit of a generalist, and I got more and more involved in the business operations, project management, and liaising with, you know, sort of government entities and manufacturers to deliver stuff like the passenger rail equipment that we often ride into work in this area. So, but there really wasn't a lot of innovation there, and it was starting to stagnate. And I was really, really fascinated with entrepreneurship after working with my wife to open up her own business, and I was just really enjoying that. And so I went and found that there was actually a sort of job for this. Was product management was what I was interested in, introduced to, and I went to BioVision, a startup at the time. Approximately 6 years ago now, so MyoVision was involved in building IoT devices and web-based software for government groups to better manage traffic signals. So you get stuck at a traffic light, right? Well, the holy grail here was autonomous traffic signal controls, and so I started to get exposed to a lot of different technologies and a rapidly growing team at MyoVision, rotated through a lot of different roles, often working on very new products and trying to birth new product lines as that company grew, doubling its team size, doubling its revenues, doubling its product offerings in lots of different verticals. A lot of fun, a lot of lessons learned. But the thing I started to become fascinated with and started to realize was a trend in my career was interest in systems design. And I started to become more fascinated with the evolution of human systems and systems design in that team as it was growing, the organizational behavior of that team. And so that led me to an internal tool that was a spin-out that was brewing called Teal Software. And that led me to trial selling in the early stages of that software to blockchain companies. They stumbled into me, I stumbled into them, and I'm now working with Consensys, one of the world's largest incubators for Ethereum-based applications. That's my history. The reason I mentioned that and the reason I did it a little bit thorough is it influences the bias in which I view this. It influences what I'm seeing, and so it may be completely inapplicable to your experiences and what you're trying to do, and you may not believe it. So I just want to make sure that bias is out there. So I am a generalist to the core as well. Anyways, we're going to talk about work changing, how we work changing. I like thinking about a fairly simplified model of a team. Now, a team is actually a really complex adaptive system, right? But if we want to try and simplify it, at its basis components, it's people and their backgrounds, like the one I just shared. Habits, some people like to call that process. I think it's a dirty word, so I just like the word habits. But really, it's just the habits that we form as a team, and those evolve too. As we build a collaborative practice. And then tools, right? The tools that we work. And so habits and tools are things that help us work more efficiently, but to do what? This team is relatively inert if we don't have drivers. And so another key component to a team and what it's achieving when we talk about doing work together are the drivers, the purpose, the mission, the goals. And many of these are really just a shared intersubjective reality, which is kind of a funny way of just saying that we actually form a collaborative belief around what we're supposed to be going after, and then that motivates us to change this system in some way. So whether we're swapping a tool, a habit, for a person. This whole thing, if you change one thing, because it's a complex adaptive system, you can see ripple effects to the rest of the system. So we're going to talk about tools today, though, because blockchain, in effect, is really at its base just a tool. I'm a fan of Conway's Law, or Conway's Corollary in this case, and that's the way teams organize themselves and communicate will trend towards matching the tools they work with and the systems they build. One of the things that I had angst about as I started to just introspect about how teams work was the fact that most of the organizational behavior textbooks that I picked up were written, or at least the practices were established during the Industrial Revolution, which means it's no wonder phrases like, you know, feeling like a cog in a machine is a thing. If Conway's law is true, effectively we were working in mechanized environments with mechanized tools. We felt mechanized, mechanical sort of ways of interacting with those environments, and that's the way in which we organized. One of the easiest ways to take a look at this and how a tool and a shift in a tool can change the behaviors of a working group and its working style is just looking at the history of Agile. So in the 1970s, near the tail end of that Industrial Revolution, you have sort of waterfall project management, and it's coming into its heyday, and it's really hardening itself over the next 20 years. But around the 1990s, we of course start to pick up the prevalence of software development. A new technology is emerging, and so is a new method, or a series of new methodologies, new experiments in how to work with that technology more efficiently as a team. So RAD, Rapid Application Development, UP, DSDM, XP, Scrum, maybe one of the few, for maybe you recognize some of these, but Scrum's probably the one that we recognize most today. That's actually interesting, right? You know, there's a lot of experimentation, and then there's a bit of consolidation downstream. And this is happening in parallel to, of course, what we all knew was happening technologically and product-wise in the markets with, you know, sort of the birth of the internet. Around the 2000s, the manifesto comes into play. So we start to realize that all these experiments have some commonality, and a bit of a framework or a manifesto emerges around this new way of working. And, you know, it starts to kind of proliferate. We've got more scaled up ways of dealing with this. How do we do this at scale? How do we do this in terms of the way we interact with other teams, with safe and less? And, you know, around the, you know, 2010s, we're also seeing sort of the, you know, the peak of the, you know, sort of the web 2.0. It's starting to feel like, you know, this is a really fairly mature thing. Around the same time, Agile's pretty mature, and it's actually starting to go really mainstream. I'm watching HR teams use it. I'm watching marketing teams use it. You know, in the last year or so, we actually encountered a sales team, I think it was Stack Overflow in the UK, that was using it to do sprints for sales and following the methodology. So this framework really started to proliferate. I'd argue, like all innovation curves, those who are familiar with the S curves of innovation, right? You know, we were starting to feel maturity. I'm going to make an argument that there is a new technology, one I'm going to focus on a little bit myopically today, but around 2008, we get the Bitcoin white paper, blockchain starts to hit its fermentation period. And you can make an argument as to where we're in this curve. We're most certainly, or at least I have a position that we are not in the vertical takeoff period yet, and we are still more in the fermentation period of this technology. But I'd say that similar to what we saw, we should watch for a new system of working to start to emerge and some diverse experiments related. We look at blockchain. I'm not going to dive deep on the protocol or all the variants that have emerged in terms of blockchains, but I like to think of it this way as a definition that, you know, blockchain is a technology that helps people perform trusted transactions between each other by decentralizing the system that manages the transaction. I realize this is, you know, one of many ways to interpret this, but why I'm focusing on the trust and decentralization is why I see those two pillars as having some interesting effects on the way people are working. So of course, as I said, I'm not going to dive into this, but for, you know, high level, you've effectively got that distributed, decentralized computing environment with a protocol forming some form of consensus or validation of the transaction, and in the case of blockchain, maintaining a mutable ledger or record of that transaction that is shared by all parties. So, super high level. I apologize. We're going to plow right ahead and say that, you know, there's some interesting things that happened post white paper of Bitcoin, and that is that some more sort of what I would describe as a general purpose or programmable blockchain started to emerge. Ethereum's the one t-shirt indicating that I've had a little more exposure to, as I mentioned, generalist, product manager, not a developer, but in the fall started to get really embedded in the Ethereum community. And what was interesting about Ethereum is that because it's programmable through Solidity, new applications can merge over top of this. A simplistic way of maybe looking at a blockchain would be like, oh, it's like a database, or maybe it's a new way to do decentralized compute, but along those sort of blurred boundaries, at the end of the day, though, you still have something that is fairly general purpose, just like any other decision you're making in a tech stack. You're making a decision of why you're employing this and what unique properties it's bringing forward in your tech stack. But what happens inevitably is that these applications start to emerge, and this is where I start to get fascinated. There are a category of applications that are emerging related to work distribution and collaboration. Starting here, because this one's really not that big a jump off of some of the things that were already happening in Web 2.0 with things like Elance, Upwork, these ideas of bounties. But what's sort of interesting here is that these bounties are starting to get paid in any cryptocurrency. And why that's particularly fascinating is you can start to incentivize collaboration, people who are not employees to receive micro stake in the project itself, aligning incentives to the people who are participating. I think that has a fairly interesting behavioral mechanic in comparison to an Elance where I just received fiat dollars for the work that I've done. The other interesting thing is happening here, Colony would be an interesting project around that. A little less bounties, it's got bounties but with a twist. Colony's early experiments with their protocol are around the idea of creating like a Trello board where each item on the Trello board is incentivized. So you can start to actually do agile with like a distributed, decentralized team of contractors who may not know the name of each other, but are able to participate in a project for some finite period of time. Might hop on a Zoom call, might be on a shared Slack, and then they're receiving sort of micro rewards relative to the finalization of the tasks. Now, we realize that some of these things have extents, right? Bounties, right? You need a really well-defined task to pull off a bounty in a relatively efficient way of outsourcing that work. And also, in this Colony thing, you need to have a reasonably defined or time-bounded thing. An example would be like a movie. You come together in a movie, there's some pretty well-defined roles. You do those roles, you disband, and then you reband, and you often reband with people that you've worked with previously. So Colony might be something that's pointing towards that direction of work. But some neat things evolving here that align incentives, and the thing that's really interesting, and this starts to get even more interesting in my eyes, is governance and organization. So DAO, or a decentralized autonomous organization, got a lot of hype, particularly around the hacks associated with its early emergence. Read up on that if it's interesting to you. But what was most interesting was what it's trying to bring forward and how a lot of experiments are emerging around token-based governance. So the ability with an immutable record on this decentralized infrastructure to basically have people who have tokenized identity or tokenized stake and able to vote through various mechanisms. And what's interesting about this is you can start to digitize through these smart contracts experiments in all kinds of different governance that we can find some potentially interesting applications to you. So yeah, simple democracy or multiple signatures required to a certain threshold to unlock something. Or we can talk about liquid democracy where we delegate our votes. And so I could liquidly move my token to somebody else so they have the ability to vote, revoke that and bring it back to myself on a different issue or item. And that's something that can be interesting in terms of, if we think of politics today, right, we kind of bring someone in and I've delegated my vote to them for a long period of time. In certain situations we could play with pulling that around and moving it a little more fluidly through a system like this, provided it can be trusted and secure. Time-lock multisig is kind of interesting one to play with as well, where you have this idea of, if 80% or more is in play, then have already pushed yes in something, it can unlock faster and faster on the higher percentages. As lower percentages, you get this sort of, you program what kind of decay you want on that, but let's imagine less than 10%, and it'd be like 5 years before this thing's going to happen until people start voting it up. And so you can have this time lock that's variable based on the people who are putting momentum behind it or pulling momentum away. Another one that's really interesting here are token curated registries, or TCRs. And there's a crypto primitive that basically is like a group of token, you know, holders who are, its job is to curate a list of some kind. And so this can be used in a lot of different applications, but one of the interesting things is to think of a submission of a proposal, you know. I think this should be on the list, or this should be considered to be adopted. You know, the person who's submitting stakes, and there's basically a challenge period where it will flow onto the list if nobody who's got the job of curator is going to vote against it or put it into a challenge. If the challenge happens, a game is played to basically, you know, everybody then has to vote if a single person challenges, and then there's some threshold to the game in terms of how that plays out, and someone's either bumped off the list and lose their stake, or they get onto the list and they maintain their stake. And that stake might be, you know, a financial stake, it might be a reputation stake. There's lots of ways to play this game, but at the end of the day, there are a lot of permutation combinations and some applications that are starting to emerge to play with these things. Now you combine that with one of the most sort of hyped, or some people like to say, you know, the first killer app on some of these platforms, which is the initial coin offering or initial token offering. What we've got here is a video playing of the latter portions of 2017 and how much capital was flowing in to the various entities on the D3, nice little D3 animation here. And so, yeah, a boatload of capital flowed in. Now, this is really interesting. And that's just a fact, it flowed in. There's interesting in that, like, billions in latent capital was released by this new mechanic. There was relatively minimal barrier to entry. Those who had a really good idea and wanted to put that idea up and see if people were willing to support it were able to access capital. It didn't matter where they were geographically, it didn't matter who they knew and who they could network with in order to raise that capital. They were able to post on the internet and raise that capital. They had a good idea, a good team, and, you know, they were able to maintain faith. Now, this is, like, everything in this system that I've just described is in its, you know, in maturity, like Agile was back in the 90s. But what is clear here is that there's a lot of experimentation, and there's a lot of tough lessons being learned, probably like there were some pretty tough lessons learned in the early stages of Agile delivery that brought forward a lot of those lessons that we now share in forums like this, or on blogs, or some of the codified frameworks like Scrum.org and others. So there's, it's just basically to highlight some of the experiments that are going on, but if you take these three categories, and you start to add them up, you have the opportunity to have an idea, raise capital, have a governance system, have a relatively modest footprint on the actual employees in your company. And one of the things that I didn't mention on the previous slide is open law, which is this idea of legal contracts, like a markdown language for Solidity code to put legal contracts on the Ethereum blockchain. And what's interesting about that is you end up with the ability to have these things actually be executable. So if you exercise a clause, like I am employed, I am no longer employed, you know, then the severance is automatically paid, kind of thing. And so this is pretty interesting because you can get more efficient and rapid transactions. And if that's the case, maybe we're going to get greater liquidity in the talent market. You know, maybe we're going to get, you know, greater capital flowing into innovation. Maybe we're going to get greater participation and equal participation or equal access to the average person, citizen or investor who wants to participate, or the average person with a great idea who wants to bring that to fruition. So these are things that I think are rather interesting, but all of these are going to bring about some rather interesting lessons learned. And I think the ICO one in particular, if you spend some time Googling about ICOs, SEC regulation, and some of the challenges around fraud, you're going to see this is a great example of an area that still needs to ferment. So Conway's Law, the way teams organize themselves will tend to match the tools they work with and the systems they build. And I'm starting to notice with my time at ConsenSys that now it's grown to 1,000 plus people globally, but it feels like 50 plus companies kind of operating under this umbrella at ConsenSys, and talent is starting to move frictionlessly. And you know, we've got about a 300% annual headcount growth as a result. And in terms of traditional management at ConsenSys, there are no managers and no report lines, which is absolutely sort of fascinating. And the reason is because this group that established ConsenSys Their philosophy was, we need to behave like the nodes on a decentralized network that is Ethereum in the way that we collaborate. And to me, that just shows how people who often are working with new tools tend to adopt philosophies and practices that match those tools. One of the great examples is microservice architecture and how teams end up in organizing and communicating when that's the architecture that they want to use. Thank you so much. Living at 20,000 feet on this, I'd be happy to take questions.
So inside of Consensus, are you guys using any specific blockchain tools or practices or just doing your work?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question. The answer is yes, and it's rapidly growing day over day. So it started, you know, relatively conservatively. So the bounties network that I mentioned, there are live bounties posted by many of the Consensus companies. I don't know what the current state of the bounties network is, but I think I've seen stuff from like Uport, MetaMask, and some others on that system. So we do use that as a mechanic to, and we also dog food that internally. So we have a private bounties network internally that we use to distribute some work tests internally. Particularly things around dog fooding, because there's 40 plus decentralized apps being built. We often try to give each other our alphas and see what's happening, and so we adopt some incentive mechanics around that. That's one of the simplest that's emerged, and then there's a number of sort of side experiments. So I've heard teams that were playing in the TCR space and totally curated registries and started to use that as a way to actually, they use the TCR to maintain the list of who's on their team. And so that creates some pretty interesting dynamics with a lot of trust for them to run that experiment as a team, as you can imagine, but people are doing that. So in terms of the way we do work, those are some of the early ones. I'm also seeing the governance ones starting to emerge a little bit more. So there's a major sort of compensation philosophy overhaul that is starting to experiment with some governance. There's an internal accounting system that's emerging that's related to effectively like an internal token or what we're playing with called a mesh coin, and some experiments are emerging on starting to create internal trade and incentive mechanics. So yeah, those are some of the experiments that are emerging, but yeah, it's underway. Thanks. Next question. Yes?
What are some of the ways to disputes decentralization?
Yeah, brilliant question. So I wish Mark Balin was up here. He's a co-founder of, and does talks locally every once in a while. I think like the Block 3, Block 4 meetups that are hosted locally. So he's actually been spending a lot of time thinking about arbitration since bringing the bounties network online. The simple answer is it's really hard, it's unresolved, and experiments are underway, but you can start to sort of visualize using some of those governance mechanics that I mentioned, layering those into solutions where you can effectively have arbitration that's using some token-based mechanics. But early days, at this point in time, there isn't a substantial difference. So at the end of the day, on the bounties network as it is today, you don't have an arbitration, an on-chain arbitration mechanic. You have on-chain transaction for yes, we're completed, the funds locked in the smart contract, distributed, but you don't have that on-chain. Great question, because that also plays into some of the other applications that are up there, like say supply chain, right? So cool, mutable record, you can trace supply chain, but what happens when something goes wrong in the supply chain? You just know that that's the person that put lead in the baby formula. You don't have an on-chain mechanic necessarily yet today with some of these emerging solutions. So, yeah. Yeah, go for it.
I'd like a yes, no, or more complicated answer to the following statements. On the blockchain, code owns itself. Therefore, blockchain is the operating system for the technological singularity.
I'd say more complicated.
Yeah,
but why don't we give you a mic? It's a good one.
So if I ask for a yes, no, or more complicated answer to the following statement. So on the blockchain, code owns itself. I think we all sure to understand that. So is blockchain the operating system for technological singularity?
mean, it's an interesting question. I don't want to personally take an opinionated stance on this, because I'm one of those people that doesn't sort of like supposing what the future might unfold. But I also be curious in the spirit of the dialogue. Do you have an opinion that you've started to form around that question?
I'm going to answer with yes, because, well, so here's a thought experiment. If code owns itself, you can write a smart contract that can run its own code, and therefore it can technically evolve and take over. So, and blockchain is the only tool alive today that you can actually pull it off with.
I think that's a fair answer. Yeah, I mean, maybe I was reading into it and thinking, like, is it going to be the thing that pulls it off? And like, yeah, I think there's some other forces at play, but is it a platform or substrate that could?
Yes.
Yeah, I think that's probably a fair answer. Yeah, thank you. And yeah, I mean, frankly, that's one of the, in the fall of last year when I started to dive into the space, and my technical co-founder Victor and I were chatting, that was one of the things we love to meet. A lot of really exciting emerging fields right now that have some interrelationships, you know, of course AI, blockchain, and quantum computing, and it'd be intriguing to see how the three of them dovetail up. Great question. Anyone else? Yeah.
What do you feel the impact of the European Union's right to be or not on blockchain technology?
Beautiful. So is it GDPR? Am I getting that acronym
yeah.
right? Yeah. So GDPR. The question is what European Union's right to be forgotten. I think this is fascinating. I have a personal opinion on it. I think this is great. I think it's a bit of an accelerant. Because one of the things that I didn't dive into today in terms of some of the things that are being experimented with on blockchain, and this does have implications to work as well, is self-sovereign identity, right? So the ability to take better control and better management of one's personal identity and personal data. If you're the one holding the private keys and you have to authorize the use of your data, you can start to protect more sensitive data and manage that data yourself and manage who has the opportunity or the permissions to work with it. Now that's fascinating because in the state of GDPR, that's effectively, from my interpretation, the intent of what GDPR is trying to do. They're saying some of these technologies, as they've emerged when the internet didn't really have a sense of management of one's identity and one's data exhaust, so to speak, there are some people who started to take advantage of this and build business models that take advantage of this. GDPR says, you know what, enough is enough. You can't bury a bunch of stuff in your end user license agreements. That take advantage of people, they have the right to take back that right. Now, I think most people are responding with fairly lo-fi methodologies to adhere to GDPR initially, and I think blockchain brings forward the opportunity to have a higher tech solution to self-sovereign identity and management of one's identity and data. So that's an awesome question. I hope I answered it appropriately. Yep.
So I think in the GDPR question that ultimately your right to be forgotten is limited by the laws that say that this transaction is immutable and you can't be forgotten. And so,
yeah.
You know, it comes down to if the blockchain has a transaction, you can't exercise your right to be forgotten in that case.
So I love it. So yeah, I think you bring forward like another interesting detail that's in the mix, which is exactly that. If you have an immutable record, it's public, you know, and then technically the ledger never forgets. So is that in violation of the intent?
No, it's not a violation of the intent. They allow for that in GDPR.
Yeah, yeah. And so, I apologize because I'm not an expert in GDPR. But at the same time, I think there are still some concerns around blockchain use, because I do know that our legal team is having conversations about how best to work with the GDPR legislation as well as the European Union and understanding, you know, what it means.
I think there's still a conception out there that if you purchase something in Bitcoin that your identity is protected, which it isn't really.
Yeah, it's fascinating you mentioned that. I think we were having a side conversation before the talk about that. That was basically, the idea that there might be a perception that although your wallet might be anonymized in a Bitcoin transaction, that there may still be the ability to trace a transaction back to an individual, and yeah, I think there are some who say that, blockchain actually brings forward the opportunity through the immutable record to have greater sort of traceability of those transactions. And that's actually something that for the groups to say like tax evasion or fraud might be, at first it looks like, Bitcoin is, completely anonymous and that, that's a problem, but, the flip side of the coin might be, oh, you've got this immutable record and you actually can, audit this, and that might be net better than maybe some of your legacy systems. So,
The legal framework says that the record is immutable, at least for 7 years.
So, I apologize, you basically got into an area that's not a, an area that I've dived into myself much, and so thank you for sharing your thoughts on it. Yeah, thank you.
On that note,
yeah.
Thank you.